Thank you, Krista. Good morning, choir. Good morning, church. Those gathered and joined us online, it is so good to be together this morning. It is a beautiful day, yes? And God has given us this time and this space to be together, to worship, and to celebrate Holy Communion. As we prepare for our time together, I want to remind everybody that this evening at 4 o'clock at our Fry Road campus, we will celebrate what we call State of the Church. I know that we have mentioned this the last couple of weeks, and I want to encourage you, if you are not already planning to attend, to please join us. It's out at the Fry Road campus. We do this every year about this time of year. We like to flip-flop venues. It's like the holidays where you got to take turns who is hosting. But this year, it's going to be a great celebration, as it has in the past, a time for us to just give God thanks for 2023 and give God thanks for what he is prepared to do in and through us in 2024. And so it's a special time for us to gather all together. Please make a point to join us if you are not already. If you are visiting with us this morning, a special welcome to you. We have these Connect cards that are in the pew pockets in front of you, and that is a great place for you to write down your contact information so that we can be in touch with you in the week ahead. Thank you for worshiping with us. See if you have any questions about what it is to worship here at Foundry and to follow Christ together. On the back of those cards is also a place for prayer requests. This is something that you can fill out and turn in to the black boxes or to any member of our host team. We believe that praying with and for each other is what we are called to do in Christ, and there is power when we lay our requests down at the feet of Jesus. Yes? So those are the things that we endeavor to do together as a church. As we prepare our hearts for worship, or continue to prepare our hearts for worship, would you stand and let us turn to these words from Psalm 99. The Lord reigns. Let the nations tremble. Great is the Lord in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father God, you are indeed great. And as you have reigned since the beginning of time, Lord, we sit under your hand this morning. And I just ask that we just be ready for whatever your word has for us today, whether it comes to us through music or through the spoken word or through fellowship or through service in your name, Lord, that we would just be ready to listen and to hear and to be moved by your spirit in this place this morning. We give you praise, Lord, because you are holy, and in your holiness, you hold us together. Let this be our prayer as we continue to worship together in your name. Amen. Amen. Friends, let us lift our voices in praise.
Yeah. you join me as we affirm our faith together? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hey friends, every week here we have an opportunity to give back to God, to participate in the ministry that he is doing here through Foundry, through our giving financially to help people know, follow, and share Jesus. So I want to just thank you for the ways you give and encourage you to do so. When we give, we know that God works through us, and what a joy it is to see the difference that it makes and that God's work is done through our financial partnership in ministry here at Foundry. It's also just an amazing way to express your faith and to take a step forward in your faith and to put your faith in action. And God always shows up and grows our faith when we trust him in this way. And so I want to encourage you, no matter where you are, you can give in one of the ways listed on the screen, online, by text, or by mail. Or if you're worshiping with us in person, of course, there are boxes at the exits where you can give as well. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for your grace to us and the way that your grace works through us. Lord, we pray that you would take our offering, take our whole lives, and use us for your purpose, that more people might know you, come to follow you, and share you with our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Glory in the highest, God will shout.
Amen. Will you stand with me? And let us pray together. O Lord, open our hearts and mind by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our reading is from Luke 24, verses 44 through 49. He said to him, "This is what I told you while I was still with you, that everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." And then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you to you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
I want to say that in 10 days is not Valentine's we're looking forward to. It's the beginning of Lent for us in the church. We got some Lent groups coming up, and I want you to be on the lookout for them. And especially if you're not part of a group right now, this is a wonderful season to get in 6 weeks, connect with other folks, get into the Word, and allow yourself to do something different. Perhaps introduce a new rhythm into your life. So be on the lookout for that in about 10 days. I remember growing up and having family devotionals, and I was very blessed to, as a very young kid, to be around parents that knew God's word and would talk to me about God's word. And I knew big words, even in second grade, words like Trinity and tribulation and rapture. I knew all this stuff growing up and kind of grew around it. And I remember years ago, now that Jen and I had our kids and we're trying to figure out how to grow them up in the church and the ways they should go, and we would do family devotionals. And we had everything from, at that time, from like a 10-year-old all the way to someone in diapers, five kids, trying to figure out how do we teach them God's word. And so I would take a devotional and we would start acting parts out of the Bible and everything else. And after we got into a rhythm, they realized that a lot of the questions that I would ask had one of three answers. It was either God, Jesus, or the Holy Spirit. It didn't matter what it was. And when I asked for a volunteer, like, "Hey, who wants to be the guy with the deformed hand?" And they're like, "I do." "And who wants to be the demon-possessed man?" "I do." You know, "And who wants to be Jesus?" And they'd fight for these things. And then I talk about how did this happen. They would sit there, and if it didn't matter what the question was, like, "Hey, what did the man think?" And it was like, "Holy Spirit." And that was the answer. It's our go-to now around our family. It doesn't matter what theological question is asked. You can't go wrong with the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit of God is the third person of the Trinity. And as Christians, we affirm that God is three in one. We just affirmed our faith together, and we say this every week here in this venue. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And the triune God has always been present in our lives ever since creation. And before then, the Holy Spirit is God. We read in Genesis chapter 1, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and now the earth was formless, empty, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. We get this vivid image of God's Spirit moving over these waters to create something new. The Spirit was active in creation, and the Spirit is still active today in our lives, creating new things. The Spirit is able to take that was without shape and form it. The Spirit is able to fill that which is empty. Not only was the Spirit present at creation, but so was the Son. The Apostle Paul asserts in Colossians chapter 1 that the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. And later in that same chapter 1 of Genesis that we just read from, we get this interesting phrase that pops up. And then God said, let us make mankind in our image. The God, the triune God, decides to make human beings in his likeness. And you get this plural noun in the Hebrew of us, letting us make them in our image. This is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit working together to make what we know today as humanity. When God created humanity, he breathed into us. That word in the original language means to breathe life or breath of life, this idea of spirit. This is where the Father breathing into us the Spirit of God, thus making us the image bearers of God. Therefore, you and I carry the very image of the living God within our souls, within our spirits. However, as a result of sin entering into this world, into everything that we know, into creation, into our souls, the image that was given to us is now marred, is now damaged. So is our relationship with God, so is our relationship with one another, with our environment. Everything that God intended it to be, how things were intended to be, are now broken. That wholeness, that idea of shalom that was created is no longer there. And yet God from the very beginning institutes a plan to restore all of creation and to even restore the image within us that has been damaged. Now the Spirit of God was active throughout the Old Testament, not just in Genesis, and doesn't all of a sudden appear randomly in the book of Acts when we start celebrating and thinking about Pentecost. I know there's some traditions that think very little of the Holy Spirit. It's just focusing on our relationship with Christ, which is important, but it's not the end all be all. In Genesis chapter 31, the Spirit of God came down on the people who had built the things of the tabernacle. In the book of Numbers, the Spirit of God falls on 70 elders at the tent of meeting, anointing them for leadership. In Deuteronomy chapter 34, Moses lays his hands on Joshua and he prays that he would be filled with the Spirit of God because he was to be the next leader, his successor. In the book of Judges, there's a long sequence of examples of the Holy Spirit coming upon the judges. In 1 Samuel, the Spirit of God comes down on Saul to prophesy. In that same book, David is anointed by the Spirit of God to be the next king. 2 Peter looks back on all the prophets and declares it this way, that they all carried along by the Holy Spirit and they spoke from God. In 2 Kings, Elijah prays for a double portion of the Holy Spirit. That's actually a wonderful prayer for all of us to pray. That yes, God, I believe in you. I believe that you live in me, God, but I want a portion, a double portion of your Holy Spirit so that I can be present here in this world. And that's where our relationship with God is more than just me and my family, that everything's okay and that I'm doing the right things. It's that God begins to work in me and begins to use me, use all of us in a way that creates an impact in this world that points people to Jesus. In the book of Job, Job is looking back at Genesis, acknowledging that he was created by the Spirit of God, that the Spirit of God was breathed into him. When David was conflicted about his sin, he prays, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Also, after he recognizes that there is no place that he can go and hide from God, he pens these words, where can I go from your Spirit? In Isaiah chapter 44, Isaiah speaks a prophecy that proclaimed also by Peter at Pentecost. It says, I will pour out my Spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. Then we know Isaiah 61, it says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. These are the words that Jesus spoke in the New Testament. Then there's also mention of the Holy Spirit in Ezekiel, in Daniel. When we come to the book of Joel, we get this formidable promise of the person and power of the Holy Spirit saying, and afterward, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my Spirit in those days. The prophet Micah declared that he was full of power of the Holy Spirit as he faced the injustices of his day. When faced with an impossible situation, the prophet Zechariah said, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Almighty. See, the men and women that came before us in the Old Testament acknowledged the very presence of God through his Holy Spirit in their lives. So throughout the Old Testament, we have this image of the Holy Spirit at work, interacting with humanity. But it doesn't stop there. See, the Holy Spirit has always been present and has always been close to us, especially as it deals with forming us more and more back into the image, restoring that image within us, and allowing us to carry out the purpose and calling upon our lives. If we reduce the purpose of our lives to mere tasks or occupations, then I believe that we don't have the full picture of what Christ wants to do in and through us. It's so much more than a simple vocation. Am I supposed to do A or B, a doctor, a lawyer, whatever it may be? It's so much more than that. We looked at this a few weeks ago. It's the person that we become, regardless of the job we may have and the impact that we have on other people. But understanding that it didn't just happen recently, that it's been unfolding throughout Scripture. Timothy Tennant lists 7 ministries of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament that are later expanded on also in the New Testament. It says that the Spirit is the source of all life. The Spirit is the one who makes God's revelation known to us. 3, the Spirit grants us wisdom and discernment. 4, the Spirit anoints us for effective service and leadership. 5, the Spirit convicts of sin and unites the heart so that we may not sin. 6, the Spirit manifests the power of God to heal and to transform lives and our society. 7, the Spirit universalizes God's presence to all nations. And these ministries are continued in many ways reignited within the New Testament. One of the things that I love about the way that God reveals himself to us over and over is he takes visible things to teach us invisible truths about himself, about his love, about his purposes. And throughout the Bible, we have all these different images that are used and are also carried on, not only in the Old Testament, but also in the New Testament. Some of these will be familiar to you. A dove, a cloud, fire, the breath, the voice of God, wind, water, oil, all symbols pointing to the person, work of the Holy Spirit. From the get-go in the New Testament, we encounter the Holy Spirit coming upon Jesus, anointing him for ministry. The Holy Spirit then takes him into the wilderness to be tested. The Holy Spirit seems to tie everything together from creation to the inception of the church to the ongoing work in our lives, making us more and more into the image of Christ, which is a work that the Spirit does in everyone who says, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. See, it's impossible to declare alliance with God and have no relationship with the Holy Spirit. Inconceivable. The Holy Spirit may seem foreign to us. We may be scared of the Holy Spirit because of our lack of knowledge. But I'm telling you, that is one of the ways that God is present with us. One of the ways that you and I carry on a relationship with God is by talking to the Spirit. We see this in Jesus' life as he's moving forward in ministry, in public ministry. The Spirit of God is present with him at all times, but it's also present with him as he preaches, as he proclaims the good news, as he heals the sick, cleanses those who are impure. He is empowered by the Holy Spirit for ministry in the same way that you and I are filled and also empowered for ministry here, not just for those who are on church staff. That's part of what the Spirit of God does. He empowers the gifts within you for the edification of the body and for the restoration of this world. See, Jesus shows us how to live our lives fully in the power of the Holy Spirit. And then he invites us to do it. And everything that Jesus invites you and I to do, he did it first. And the very same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is given to you. It's given to me and to you and to you and to you. You're like, yeah, I don't see that, Luis. Like, if you knew my life and everything I have to go through and everything I'm going through right now and what I experience, and sometimes we equate the Spirit of God with whether or not we feel it or not. Our feelings are not indicative, is not the measuring stick to see whether or not God is present. In my weakest moments and in times where I struggle even, I say, Holy Spirit, speak to me. There's stories of men of faith who've just thrown themselves on the floor and says, I will not move from here until your Spirit speaks to me. I think at some level there's a longing within us to have that intimacy, that connection with God, that relationship. Because we don't want to go just through the motions of life, just in it for ourselves. Because if it's in it just for me, I'm telling you, there's a lot more beneficial and a lot more fun things I could do than come here. Think about it. But that's part of what makes us the people of God. If the Spirit of God comes and moves within us, he begins this work of sanctifying us, setting us apart for God's use only here in this world. It doesn't happen overnight. It's gradual. But God begins to work in us. For a long time in my life, I focused only on the work, the completed work of Christ. Do you believe? Yes. Did he die for you? Yes. Then that was great. Then that's all you needed. Believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and you shall be saved, and that was it. And to an extent, that's true. Just believe. But this idea of believing was more than just the acknowledgement of certain theological facts. It's to say, God, I choose to follow you. Believing in Christ's completed work on the cross is central, but it's only the beginning. I made the beginning the finish line, even for myself for many years. Acknowledging Christ's love for us, deciding to follow him is only the beginning for our life in Christ. It's about placing our trust in Christ. It's about our aligning our lives to God's word. It's allowing our agendas and our priorities, whatever they may be, however smart we may be, and allowing God to restructure them. That requires some humility. That requires some courage for us to say, here's everything I know, everything I think ought to happen, but I'm going to surrender it to God. It also implies healing from our past wounds. It's learning to let go of the sin that we love so much and beginning to release it. And what I found in my life, things that I used to love, and really looked to and made a priority as I've walked with Christ slowly begin to lose their hold on me. It's unlearning certain things, certain ways of thinking. It's also adopting new ways of thinking It's the renewal of our mind that Paul speaks about. It's also engaging in new activities so that I can develop my relationship with Christ so that Christ now has more access to me. It's not so that I can just become a better person or that I can stop doing all these bad things. He says, I want you to do these things because I want to have full access to you, to your heart, to your emotions, to your position, to your talents, because I want to empower them with my spirit and I want to use you in such a way. See, when Jesus saved us from sin and death, he saved us into a new life. It's preposterous for us to think that I can come to Jesus, acknowledge him, say I follow him with all my heart and not change. Something will inevitably change. The more I fall in love with Jesus, I come to him not because I want him to change something in me, because sometimes, if I'm honest, I think I'm pretty good. But the closer I get to him, I find out, not so much. You're impatient. You can be rude. You can be critical. You gossip. You envy. I'm like, oh gosh. I'm talking about me. All right? I'm talking about you. You're like, yes, but this is this ongoing work of the Spirit. He is gentle with us. And he says, Luis, I want to change these things. Sometimes like I wasn't him. But when we do these things, we allow the Spirit to do a profound work in our lives, regardless of our circumstances, good or bad, or extremely difficult. You and I are made more and more into the image of Christ in the manner that you and I yield to the Spirit of God. We can't do this in our own strength. We can't do this in our own abilities, because if we could, then we wouldn't need the Holy Spirit. It starts with an acknowledgement, I think, almost daily to say, I need you, Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God was at work in our lives before we even knew he was aware. We were even aware that he was working in our lives. It's what we Wesleyans call prevenient grace. And as we come to Christ, things begin to shift inside of us. And it says in Scripture that he convicts us of sin. In John chapter 16 says, when he comes, he will prove the world to be wrong about sin. Which, by the way, a lot, even in a lot of churches nowadays, very little talk of sin. Sin is that which breaks God's intended purpose. Anything that stands against God's shalom, the peace, the wholeness, the integrity of the way things are supposed to be is sin. We have a sin nature. That's why we sin. He says, I want to transform that in you. The world likes to say there is no sin. It's just choices you make. It's just ways of thinking. When he comes, he will prove the world to be wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment, about sin because people do not believe in me, about righteousness because I'm going to the Father where you can see me no longer, and about judgment because the prince of this world now stands condemned. There is a difference between a conviction of sin in our lives versus condemnation. When you think, I'm horrible, I suck, I'm going to hell because of all these things that you've done, you've experienced, everything else, that internal monologue is condemnation that is not of God. That's not God speaking to you. But when you reach a place when you say, you know what? There is something that's happening here and I've engaged in this or I've been doing this and I need to step away. That's conviction. The Holy Spirit's ministry in our lives Turning away from something to something else can be defined as repentance. John Wesley would say that repentance is a step of faith. It's in response to the love and the grace of God, to the completed work of Christ. Repentance could also be defined as aligning our thinking to God's thinking, what he thinks about us, what he thinks about himself, what he thinks about others. So, you know, I used to think these things, and now that I'm in the Word and now I'm with other people, maybe I shouldn't do these things. Not because I'm going to go to hell or because God hates me, but because of what God's done, I'm responding out of love. And then I begin to be present differently in this word, in this world. See, in that turning of whatever direction we were going to another is where the Holy Spirit is working in us. He's saying to us, I believe he says to you, because he says it to me. He says, be careful with this. Stay away from that. Don't engage here. Go there. Do this. You sense it sometimes. This is more than just your gut or your consciousness. This is the Spirit of God moving, interacting with you, teaching us how to be present differently in this life in a new way. Even when times get tough and we begin to doubt, the Holy Spirit is reminding us that we belong to Jesus. To testify, the Spirit of God is testifying to our spirit that we belong to Jesus. And then he is producing something inside of us that the Word of God in Galatians 5 refers to as love. This idea of love has been hijacked and diluted by this world. Something fluffy, weak, purely emotional, sometimes even just sexual. But it's so much more than that. As we read Scripture, we know that God is holy love, and he wants to cultivate that love inside us and then through us. Galatians 5 describes what that love is. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 defines that love as well. Not only does the Holy Spirit do this for us individually, but I believe he does this in a collective sense as well. Because the God Spirit comes to dwell, to live within us. See, if God is our Lord, our ruler, our leader, that means we're not. We like to say that he is, but then we act like we're in charge. And he says, I want you to yield your lives to me because I have a better way of doing things. And that's where our nature, our flesh comes in and we battle it. But this is one of the ways that God begins to work in us. He is imparting wisdom and discernment. Anybody here need wisdom and discernment today? Yeah, okay, that's the Spirit of God will give it to you. Spend time with him and he will speak to you. He will give you boldness and conviction to make decisions and quit wavering back and forth about this or that, the other. The Spirit of God says go and you go and you don't understand it all, but you will take that step and God will supply and provide what you need to do what he's calling you to do. He will never leave you hanging. You may feel like you're free falling, but he'll never leave you hanging. The Spirit is how God is present with us today. Scripture refers to us to be the living temple of the Spirit. He has freed us from sin and death, and then he gives us life. And because of the Spirit, we're present differently in this life. Letting go of the things that once held us back, way of doing things, we begin to, the ways of the flesh begin to go. The lives of the world that we believe, laid aside. As children of God, we are led by the Spirit. That means that we no longer live in fear. We are no longer slaves. We're no longer our own. We're no longer dead, but alive. The Spirit helps us in our time of weakness. You know, like when you cry out to God and you're wondering, how is God going to, through the Spirit of God. Many times in dire situations, when I look at things that come across my desk and I'm wondering how in the world, or things in my own family, I think, how, Holy Spirit, would you draw near? I go back to my family devotional, Holy Spirit. That's all I got. In many ways, that's all we need. Amen. To say, Holy Spirit, would you do the work that you can do? when you're in a dire situation, in your marriage, in your finances, in a relationship that's broken, Holy Spirit, would you show up? Would you work? Would you do what only you can do? Because that is the Spirit that was present at creation, that was hovering, that was creating something new, that was filling that which was empty. That's the Spirit of God. He's like, no, I only do that in Genesis. That's not him. He's still working. A relationship with God is not about you and I getting the proper information or coming on Sunday morning hoping that we get inspired to do something new and something different. Yes, information helps. Inspiration is welcomed. But God's not like, you know what? I really want to inform the people on earth and inspire them. No, he says, you know, I want to come in and I want to transform them. Every one of us. He wants to transform. Question is, do you want to be transformed? Because we've been reading and studying of how we're to be witnesses in this life. But let me tell you this. If we are to be witnesses, his Spirit must first do a work in us. He first has to do a work in us. We're not merely called to testify, to be a witness to theological assertions about Jesus. We are witnesses of God's power, of his love, of his grace and his healing and freedom in our own lives. You don't need some dramatic testimony to be a witness. Acknowledge where you've been, where you are, and then where God is in those places. You can't be a witness to something you've never experienced. You can't share Jesus if you don't have Jesus. You can't give what you don't have. So, Lord, we want more of you. It's not about getting it all right with God. So then I will go be a witness. I'm going to fix this stuff up first, and then I'll go witness. Because then none of us will ever witness. In this sanctification of God making us more and more into his image, what I've come to find out is that God does draw near through his Spirit to our pain, to our emptiness, to our inadequacies, to our fears, our insecurities, our lack of knowledge, our uncertainties, our doubts. He draws near to our weakness and he says, and I am present. Would you let me guide you here and now from this place? Will you let me lead you? Will you now try it my way? And that's part of this word we don't really like, but of surrenderance. In a good way, saying, God, I give up. What I've noticed is men and women who say that to God are the best witnesses. Because he wants to work in us so that in turn he can work through us. On the evening of that first day of the week when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. This is after the resurrection. And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. And again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them. And they received the Holy Spirit. Passage that Kelly read earlier is affirming that we will be witnesses when we receive power from on high. Some of us need to allow God to breathe on us again, just as he did at creation. I want to encourage you that as we do communion this morning, if you want to pray, just a double portion of the Spirit, for the Spirit to do something in your life. If you just say, Holy Spirit, would you use me? That is the longing that is beginning to stir within you. Would you linger at the altar and let one of us just pray for you and with you? Let us pray. Jesus, we thank you for loving us the way that you do, for coming to us. Lord, we need you. We need you more and more every day. But Lord, I know that many of us are facing crazy situations in our lives and circumstances. Things that seem impossible to think, how in the world did we get here? But Lord, this is not impossible for you. Lord, I pray that you would move over our souls this morning. That we would draw closer to you as you draw close to us. That you would fill what needs to be filled. That you would form that which is formless. You separate what needs to be separated and unite what needs to be united. But that all of us here in some measure would surrender a little bit more to the work of your Spirit so that we can be the witnesses you've called us to be, created us to be, because this world needs it. We thank you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
As we approach the communion table together, I want to remind you that at Foundry, we practice an open table. That means that this is not a table tied to membership in this church or any Methodist church. This is a place where we approach the table as people who are not complete, but who are open to that work of the Spirit in us, that ongoing work of God's goodness and presence in our lives. And we are assured that as we approach this table, we will be met by his presence and in his Spirit. Would you pray with me now as we confess and repent before God? Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, friends, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. As a forgiven and a reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for you formed us in your image and you breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast, for you delivered us from captivity. You made covenant to be our sovereign God, and you spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people of earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Would you pray with me now the way he taught his disciples? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Will our servers come forward? We remember on the night in which he gave himself up for us, that he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Friends, the table is ready to be served. A reminder, if you are seated down here, you can enter from the middle aisle or the side aisles to any of the stations. If you're seated in the balcony and you'd like to remain in the balcony, our servers move from section to section. The altar is open, of course, for a time of prayer afterwards. And again, if Luis and I can lay a hand on you for anything that you feel led to ask the Spirit to come into and to lead you in, simply put your hands out like this, and Luis or I will join you at the altar. The table is served.
believe that God has met us here this morning. I believe that God will go with us as we leave this place. That's his promise to us. It's always an honor to get a chance to pray with you. Because you get a peek behind the curtain of the Sunday morning facade that we just inevitably put on. But I want you to remember this. I said this line earlier. The Spirit of God wants to work in you so that he can work through you. Many times we just want him to work around us and for us. But he wants to work in us so that he can use us in a powerful way. So why don't you stand as we get ready to sing. And as we leave here, let's do so in the certainty that God's Spirit has gone before us, that he is in us, and that he will be with us, reminding us of whose we are and of God's love for us and why we're here. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All God's people said, amen. Amen.